Bonjour à toutes et à tous. Donc, je vais vous présenter.
Good morning, everybody. I'm going to show you what we're doing at Greenfield. As already touched upon, we've got the hardware part and the software part. And first and foremost, may I explain what we're doing at Greenfield. We are mainly dealing with mathematical modeling. We do model diseases on farming units. And this modeling goes through various stages. We first have to know what's going on the plot. So we do a screening of diseases. We do collect data with drones and sensor-equipped tractors. And then we do develop automatic modeling algorithm in order to do early pre-symptom screening. And it all depends on, of course, on the evolution of the disease, but this helps to gain some waste. We also do construct the model. Starting from this modeling, of course, we can opt for the host pathogenic agent cycle. We do take on board the pests, etc., and we do gauge the dispersion phenomena, for instance, and we try to design virtual fighting strategies before going in the field, before being in the field. Being in the field is the very last step when we are 100% sure that it could work and it can work. This is a type of solutions we do develop and try to integrate. We try not to be disruptive to the crops, and we try to bring added value without disturbing the practices. The end the aim of the game is to have new strategies. The advantage of models is that we can work with on several pests or diseases. A few words on our workflow. We do inoculate diseases. We do collect data that are being, as I said, collected by drone, by specific machines, and we learn how to screen, to model, and to forecast. And this is done thanks to visualization software. Yet we are not here to sell cards. We are or chips. We are here to design strategies. We are not there to sell. Sorry, mapping systems. We are here to try and sell strategies. And we work on destruction, on weeding, on uprooting. When you have a plant is ill, has got a disease, it has to be uprooted sometimes. It may have to be uprooted, it may be the only solution. But let me now focus on laser treatment, the hardware part. We try and optimize the spraying, that is to say the way phytosanitary products can be sprayed on the various plots. We do generate maps thanks to our mapping system, in order to help farmers to spray as well as possible. We know that we can decrease beetroot sporosis thanks to good spraying without impacting the yield. And this can be done thanks to appropriate algorithm. A few words on laser. We try and decrease the quantity of weed killers, of herbicides. And that's why we try to work on laser precision weeding. And in this particular case, we have a beetroot field, and all that you may have around, you may have spotted the beetroots, but there are not only beetroots. So we have to suppress all the weeds, and mechanical weeding does it better and better, but it's still difficult because you have to avoid damaging the surrounding crops, you have to avoid overturning the soil. So we try to work in the blue area thanks to our lasers. This is in the pipeline, it's not yet fully developed. What is the state of the art actually in this respect? Here you have the way it all works. We have got the what we call the destruction laser, and we have got a targeting laser which makes it possible to visualize the beam. The destruction laser is an infrared laser, so to do it properly you need targeting laser, which makes it, and which we have got a recognition system to be able to make the difference between the plants and the weeds. Thanks to the precision laser, you know what you are going to target. On this slide, you can see how it looks like in the lab. You've got some plantlets that are being tested. The camera helps stereo visualization. Then you have small mirrors, and these small mirrors are going to reflect the laser beams and to target the appropriate the targets. And you have an optical setup, and thanks to this optical setup, you can shape the beam, you can reach the mirrors that can be tilted, that can be oriented, and then you can target, you can have your final target. We have already tested this setup, this system on aphids, and well, we are working with a research lab which specializes in aphid within the framework of a research program sponsored by the French National Agency for Research. And one of the positive points of laser and that you can be very accurate, and you can visualize what is visible, all types of insects that you can visualize and that you can reach with your laser beam. We could recognize the aphids thanks to a system, so we could and we could work at 60 centimeters, at a 60 centimeters distance. I'm going to start the video, and you are going to see the number of shots per aphid. That was extremely quick. So we did size things, and we saw that we had the available and necessary dose in order to destroy 50% of the aphids. We can do better. We do not want to shoot all the aphids, we didn't want to shoot at the aphids, the speaker is saying. And if you wanted to destroy 100% of them, you would need 4% more energy. And just to give you an idea, so in fact, the energy consumption is very slight. And
on détecte les plantules.
So we can screen the plantlets. You can, well, once you have screen your plantlets, you have to position your target. Can be a four leaf plantlet. If it's too big, you cannot use the laser. Let's not forget that you are using a laser system, a highly accurate laser system, and the red cross shows you the exact position of the laser shooting. And we, of course, succeed in destroying the plantlets. And when I say we can destroy the aphids, it doesn't really mean that the plantlet is going to die, of course. We check that the plantlet is going to be safe. Well, you haven't been able to see the video. Could you click on the video? Because I'd like to show it. Please do click on the video to start it. That would be nice.
Non, c'est le slide suivant, ça, voilà.
So that's the next slide, but I wanted to have my video. Honestly, that would be nice.
Bon, d'accord.
Ah, it's not working.
Pour ceux qui
sorry
sont
about that.
Taxés,
so if you are really interested, well, it seems to be
voilà, donc
going now. So in the lower part, you can see the camera, the optical part, the tray with the plantlets. Screening or sensing is being performed, and you have the mirror, the mirrors that are orienting the beam, and we are going to switch off the light. And if we switch off the light, we can see. That's clear here that we can move the laser around. This work is still in progress, so we have to gain accuracy for the target, that's obvious. And this is what we've been doing so far. It's getting along. We've got a prototype, and we've been working on static targets, but the ultimate goal is to work with mobile targets, and laser beam will have to adjust to these mobile targets. If you go to the exhibition hall, you'll be able to see a short demo, and you will really understand how essential it is to implement a predictive side of things. The laser will have to be able to predict where the target will be on the next frame, depending on the number of frames of pictures per second, and in order to appropriately trigger the pulse. If you come to the exhibition stand, you'll see all that in details. Let's not forget that the laser is following the target thanks to the design, its design. And our goal is to have a common project and to set up this laser beam onto a mobile platform, and my friend is going to explain this second part of our experience. I am in charge of R&D at NIO. What is R&D at NIO? Well, it consists in finding solutions in order to fulfill people's needs. We know how to weed around the lettuce beds and around carrots beds, but we are closer and closer to the plants or plantlets or vegetables, and our friend's project aims at really closely targeting the plantlet. And that's why we decided to work together on this issue. We know how to move a robot in the field, we know how to hoe close to the plant, but we have to learn how to do better. Our friends knew how to target the plant, but it wasn't enough. Hence the need for a robot, and that's why we do step in with a robot Dino that can be integrated to the system. Robots that means a lot of integration. R&D means research, of course, but development. Development means integration, trying to find the optimal available solutions and looking for new technologies. And we actually trust these new techniques and these new technologies. The point is not to replace existing systems, such as active tools or some hoeing systems. The point is to complete what the robot is already doing with huge and great accuracy, thanks to the laser beam. And that's why we have decided to develop a common project and to test it in the field. By 2020, we would like to integrate our friend solutions so that we could
laser fait dans le mouvement, c'est-à-dire lui indiquer là où on va aller.
Have the two working together, laser and robot. The aim
de monter cet appareil sur le robot.
Is to have this design set up onto the robot and to start efficacy or efficiency tests. We do work test by step by step and test by step. And this is our final goal. And hopefully we will present our results next year at the next FIRA. I hope you'll get more details. Thank you.
Allez, des questions?
Des questions?
On a du mal à voir.
Parfait.
Janis Jerzko from Latvia University of Life Science and Technologies. And you mentioned you're using infrared laser. So have you thought about other lasers, other wavelengths?
So yes, we try different wavelengths in order to test which technology and which is the most efficient. And also you have the dimensions of security that enters the device. So if, for example, you use a visible laser at 555 nanometers, which is green, basically, you need to be very, very secure. If you use the IR laser, which is around 10.6 micrometers, it's very much safer. So, like, it's like any device. You have a security range around. So, if you use if you want to cut the grass, you are not going to put your hand below, in order, otherwise you will be wounded with the blades. So for the laser we chose, you just need like a transparent plastic and like 1 or 2 meters of security range. And as for the absorption of the wavelengths, IR is very well absorbed with anything containing water. So it's a good compromise. Anyway, we are still trying different technologies and finding the best trade-off, because obviously anything enters into account when you want to use this type of any technology, so obviously the price also. So we're still investigating different technologies. So far, this one is very useful. This is the technology you are using when you want to cut plastic, cardboard, or and so on. So this is very, very well spread and well-known technology.
How about the energy consumption of laser usage?
So, in the presentation, so if you want to destroy an aphid, it's not negligible, it's very, very, very small. And the laser, when it's running but not sending any light beam, this one is consuming about 150 watts, like a big light bulb. And during the impulsion, it consumes about, I think, 250 watts. But it's during, let's say, 100 milliseconds. And we obviously, it's about the same question. We are looking for technologies that would help us consume less when we are not using the laser. There is no impulsion. So the question for energy is not really a problem.
The energy consumption for bigger weeds, grass weeds, or large perennial weeds, how is that?
I didn't understand.
The energy consumption required to take out big weeds.
Ah, big weeds, okay. So we are really working on precision weeding, so the work will be mostly after sowing, and then you have the small plant that germinates. And we will work before sowing and after sowing and after germination at the stage like young plants, like four leaves or six leaves, so that we will give a chance to the plant to grow and not be disturbed by the competition. After that, when your crop is high enough, it's not disturbed by the competition of other weeds, and the laser is not after that. It won't be, I think, the best solution. But maybe we can think about different angles, different and so on. But really, it's working on young plants. For cotyledons, two or four leaves, and high weeds, it's not for the laser. Really, we work so in the furrow, just let's say like at less than 5 centimeters from the crop. So very close to the crop, and everything which is between the furrows, between the lines, it's for, I would say, other technologies like mechanical weeding. So small plants.
In this instance, maybe. Will it do 20 weeds per square meter when they're very small?
Sorry, I didn't understand.
Can it do 20 weeds per square meter?
So far we have no idea about the speed we can work on, because it's really like the prototype stage. So I mean, there is no optimization at all. First, we want to see how it works, and then we will be able to optimize all the process. The point is, potentially the laser can be very, very fast. It has to be very powerful, obviously. But potentially, yes, and also the orientation of the beam can be also very fast. I think the only real problem we will be facing is the precision, because so far, we can with the device now, actually, we can target like small things like 1 millimeter apart from 1 meter. So the precision is 1 millimeter at 1 meter. But if you add that movement, you are going to move. And still, it's very small things. It's small plants that are one millimeter in diameter. So precision will be, in my opinion, the biggest problem in the future developments.
That will be the last question.
I'm just wondering, you target specific or individual aphids, or you scan with the laser?
So as for the pests, aphids is maybe not the best in the field, right? Aphids, they always choose to be below the leaves or at the heart of the leaf inside. So they are very difficult to target. So we will mostly work on maybe other type of pests. As for the targeting, it's not a scanning. We recognize, and then we build a list of all the coordinates, and then we choose the one which will potentially leave the image the sooner, so that we don't miss any target.
So I just wonder why not to scan.
If you were to scan the surface, you would need if you want to be efficient, you need to calculate, okay, I'm going to scan 1 hectare per hour, maybe. So 1 hectare per hour means that you have to scan 1 millimeter square every, I don't know how many seconds. I have to be very fast. So the detection must be very fast, and the destruction should be synchronized with the detection.
I'm just saying that because you will certainly face a lot of challenge with the precision.
Yeah.
Especially with the Galvo. And you might also find some challenges with targeting so many points at the same time, because the Galvo has limitation on how many points you can target.
Exactly. So Galvo, actually, this is a piezoelectric motors. And we are also trying different technologies like MEMS, like other technologies, in order to increase the reliability of the targeting.
Great, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Merci. Thank you very much.